It is exactly the time to be talking about climate change, because the events leading to these bushfires were heightened, or increased risk of bushfires is linked to climate change. So in Australia, we know that climate change is driving hotter temperatures, more prolonged droughts, and that means our forests are drier. There's fuel loads there that will quickly and easily burn. And as we saw over this summer, they did burn, and they burnt very quickly and much quicker and hotter than in any other previous years. And these are also fires that were predicted by both chief scientists around the world, including in Australia. Firefighters were calling out and speaking directly to Morrison and the federal government about heightened bushfire risk this summer, and we saw it happen in our own backyard. We've known for about 40 years now that climate change is happening, and it's now actually accelerating and happening at a faster rate than a lot of people predicted. And as we've seen in Australia, these fire events are basically systematic of increased temperatures, prolonged droughts, very little rain, and our forests burnt really quickly and really severely. The estimate is a billion mammals, birds and reptiles. That doesn't include all of the probably trillions of invertebrates that died. It doesn't include other animals like bats. So it really is an underestimate. And we have a lot of populations in Australia, especially small mammals, that are small to medium sized mammals that are threatened with extinction. So we'd probably expect potentially some localized extinction events as a result of these fires. And really, we're trying to understand what is happening and what is going on out there, but I wouldn't say it'd be very good. We really need a global response to combat the impacts of climate change. Recently, in a paper that I co-authored and that was co-signed by around 11,000 scientists around the world, we put forward six steps which we think are important for the world to undertake, including Australia, to mitigate the impacts of climate change. And so number one is energy. So a massive shift in the way that we produce our energy away from fossil fuels and using renewable energy sources. Second step is reducing short-lived pollutants. It includes CO2 and methane and black soot, basically cutting that out. Thirdly, we need to protect and restore nature. Nature is one of our best allies, trees, to soak up our carbon. We need to protect what we've got. We need to basically stop land clearing and look at restoring the forests that are being land cleared at accelerating rates. We need to shift the way we produce and consume our food. In short, that means reducing meat consumption, beef and lamb, and shifting to more of a plant-based food sources. We need to look at how our economy is driving and how it's operating, and really shift away from a focus on increasing GDP and increasing wealth to looking at how we can have sustainable distribution of wealth across both the developed and the developing countries, and to all work together to basically change the way our economies are driving. And finally, the greatest source of this carbon is human population. And it's something that a lot of people don't talk about, but reducing population growth should be one of the global goals in combating basically the human footprint and the impacts that humans are causing on planet Earth. My message in regards to climate change is that we need a global response, a rapid response to change the way that we produce our energy. We need to reduce CO2 emissions and restore and protect nature. And we need to do this at a global level if we are to mitigate the impacts of climate change in Australia, like we've seen with the massive fires that have gone through here and globally.